and their quality and their expertise. Thanks a lot. Welcome you all once again.
Let's start with Mr. Harish Rao. He'll be speaking on the right approaches to investment.
Definitely, thanks to all the people who are attending, because there are too many distractions these days. You have to sleep very late at night after watching IPL matches, and it has become so interesting that you have to watch other IPL matches also to see whether Bangalore is going to qualify. Okay, so but anyway, I'm going to miss everything because I'm going on tour from tomorrow morning to places where there's no IPL coverage at all. So good, I'll be back only on 22nd and in time for the finals to see RCB lifting the trophy. Correct? Okay. There's no way that RCB is not going to win it this time. That's the only certainty on life, that RCB is going to lift the trophy. What I'm going to talk about is very uncertain. That is investments. Okay. So that is not as certain as the IPL. So when Deepak told me about the right approach to investing, I really didn't know. I didn't have to change the presentation I had, because the only presentation I always did was what I thought was the right approach to investing. Okay, so let me start with something called the Peter principles. You all, I think, saw a couple of the principles during the build up to this presentation. The Peter principles are very nice, crisp anecdotes from Peter Lynch, one of the legendary active fund managers. He ran the Fidelity Magellan Fund, and he wrote a book called Beating the Street. So in that book, Beating the Street, after every chapter, the lessons he learned, he very crisply summarized it into something called the Peter principle. The first is, never invest in an idea that you cannot illustrate with a crayon. Okay. So what Peter Lynch found, that this is an interesting anecdote. He found that there were 7 standard students in a school called St. Agnes in the place where he lived, Boston, okay, where Fidelity was based out of. And their model portfolio completely beat the S&P 500. The index, the portfolio that 7 standard students had built completely beat what the index had given and what professional fund managers had done. When he saw their portfolio, that too, it's not a small short-time investment. It was for 2 years, from 90 and 91. The entire 2 year, for a 2 year period, he found that the kids' portfolio beat the pros' portfolio. He found that, it had stocks like Walt Disney, it had stocks like Pennytech, which makes these marker pens and stuff like that. It had stocks like The Gap, a very big jeans and apparel maker. It had stocks like Nike, PepsiCo, Body Shop and stuff like that. And when he asked the students to give the rationale for this, they gave very crisp answers for their rationale. Like McDonald's, everyone has to eat. Okay, and every single investment idea was illustrated. So he found that they never had a recommended something like, some General Dynamics Electronics Corporation, no, because they couldn't illustrate it. He found that because they used something very simple, very understandable, of use in everyday life, their portfolio was much superior to the rest. So that's how he came across this principle, saying that never invest in something you don't understand, basically. So differently worded, it is never invest in an idea that you can't illustrate with a crayon. So invest in something you can understand. In stocks, as in romance, ease of divorce is not a sound basis for commitment. Not all of us can be Shoaib Maliks, correct? So ease of divorce is not a sound basis of commitment. So similarly, he says that just because you can sell a stock very easily doesn't mean that you have to pick it. So similarly, you have to look at the merits of the thing rather than just ability to get out of that particular investment. You can't see the future through a rearview mirror. Okay, again, a very apt principle. Basically, don't judge an investment based on its past performance. Okay, because past performance is usually highlighted. Don't judge it. You have to, when you drive, you look at the front. You don't look at the rearview mirror and drive all the time. So similarly, that's what he means. Lastly, gentlemen who prefer bonds don't know what they are missing. This is obviously a take on Marilyn Monroe's film, Gentlemen Prefer Blondes. So similarly, he told gentlemen who prefer bonds don't know what they're missing. Basically, you need to have an equity component in your portfolio for giving you that kicker in returns. Most Indians prefer bonds, not blondes, because there are not too many blondes in our country. If they were, they would have preferred blondes. But in India, people prefer bonds. 95% of Indians invest in bonds and fixed income. Only 5% of our money goes into equities. That's all. So are we a risk-taking nation? No, we are a very, very high risk-taking nation. Even in that fixed income, we invest only in things without. I will tell you later how we are one of the biggest risk-taking nations. Doesn't mean just that we don't invest in equity, doesn't mean that we are going for safety. Okay, there are million other things that we do which are not backed by safety. You know, some of the fixed income choices also are not risk-free. We don't, just that we don't know the risk. Many of us invest in guaranteed return, or guaranteed highest NAV products, but there's a risk in it. It's just that the advertising headline says you get guaranteed highest NAV, but that does not mean guaranteed highest return. So do not confuse guaranteed highest NAV with guaranteed highest return. All of those things will return to haunt us, and that's why probably SEBI yesterday put a clampdown on a very popular but highly questionable investment vehicle called ULIPs. Far more money, again a gem from Peter Lynch, far more money has been lost by investors preparing for corrections or trying to anticipate corrections than has been lost in the corrections themselves. Okay, so trying to double guess the market all the time and, you know, thinking that we are smart and, you know, being conservative in handling equity markets is not the right thing to do. Stay the course over a long period of time and the corrections will not haunt us. Again, Benjamin Graham, the father of value investing, probably the first person to address investing as a science. Individuals who cannot master their emotions are ill-suited to profit from investment process. So basically, your biggest enemy is your own head. Your own emotions are your biggest enemy as far as investing is concerned. So that is a different field of science called behavioral finance, which examines in detail why we make some irrational decisions and why man is not necessarily a rational animal. Benjamin, these are some gems from Benjamin Graham in his book, The Intelligent Investor. In one of those seats that you have, I think it's recommended as a very good investment reading. You must buy that book, it's affordable. The Indian edition is only 400 rupees. The market is a pendulum that swings from undeserving optimism to unjustified pessimism. Always the optimism seems to be undeserving because it goes up too high, and pessimism seems to be unjustified because it comes down too low. Okay, so the problem is we come when the market is at the undeserving optimism and we exit when it is unjustified pessimism. That's the wrong thing that we do. Ideally, we should stay the whole course to capture an entire cycle. The returns from equities or any risk-bearing investment will come only if you are there throughout the entire market cycle. So you need to be there throughout the market cycle. What a share is and what is not. Now, this has also been adopted by Warren Buffett. Like Gerard was the guru for Deepak, Benjamin Graham was the guru for Warren Buffett. Okay, so much of what Benjamin Graham says has been totally subscribed to by Warren Buffett. A share is not just a streaming number in a ticker or is not an electronic blip. Sadly, for 95% of equity investors, that is what just a share is. That's the price. Yesterday it was 120 rupees, today it is 110 rupees. It's a lousy investment. I lost money. So that is what it is not. Basically, a share represents an ownership interest in an enterprise or a franchise, and the price should ideally reflect that. Now, I'll talk about this later. Prediction addiction. Again, many investors are addicted to what the market will look like after some point in time.